Welcome back, everyone, to Open Line. Fascinating debate tonight about the Electoral College. Should we move toward electing our presidents with more of a national popular vote, or should we stay with the Electoral College? We have two people joining us via Zoom on opposite sides of this issue. We have Trent England, who wants to keep the Electoral College. He's with Save Our States, coming to us from Oklahoma. And we have Ray Haynes, spokesman for the National Popular Vote, coming to us from California, former state senator out there. Let's go to the phones here. Let's go to Chris. Hello, Chris. Chris, are you there?
Hi there.
Hi. What's on your mind, Chris?
Well, I don't know. I'm torn about the whole thing. I definitely think that the Electoral College gives a better voice to places like Tennessee, which is important for me, being from Tennessee, not only being from Tennessee, but being from the middle of nowhere in Tennessee. So it's important for me to have my voice heard, and I definitely feel like going to the popular vote certainly shifts that focus away, not only out of Tennessee, but out of the country, and we lose some. Now, I do like the idea of destroying the two-party system. I think it's a mess. I think it's problematic, and certainly I think a popular vote could do that. But I don't know if the ends justify the means.
Interesting. So you, let's talk about that. He says doing away with, lessening the impact of the two-party system. Let's say we go to a national popular vote. What does that do to the two-party system, Ray, in your opinion?
Well, I'll use California as the best example. California is the largest popular vote election for the chief executive in the country, and the two-party system has been healthy throughout the entire process. I actually think what drives the two-party system in the U.S. is more tradition and the fact that we elect our legislators by districts and not by percentages of the vote, which most parliamentary systems do. I get into the details, but it's irrelevant to the discussion. But the bottom line is, if you elect your legislators by districts, you tend to do it in two parties, and that's what keeps it. California has had a healthy two-party system for years. I don't like the guys that are in charge, but it still is a two-party system. Most states, again, Texas, the second largest popular vote system in the for choosing a chief executive in the country, also has a healthy two-party system. So the bottom line is, the Electoral College is not what is positive or negative on the two-party system.
Trent, what do you think about
that? A whole bunch of other factors.
I think I've heard you or read something you've written that you think it would endanger the two-party system. But what do you think? What does it do to the two-party system, in your opinion?
I do think that shifting away from the Electoral College would create a big opening for spoiler candidates, splinter parties. Ray makes a good point there, right? Which is, we have all of these other offices that are winner take all, right? U.S. Senate, House, you know, all these other things are still going to be winner take all no matter what. Ultimately, the presidency is still winner takes all, right? I mean, Ray wants one big giant winner take all system. The Electoral College creates this two-tiered system that represents the states, as Chris mentioned. I worry about the Michael Bloombergs and the Tom Steyers, who have, you know, billions of dollars. And it's not that they would win, and I think this is, I don't know if Chris and I would agree or disagree on this, but it's that they could begin to hold the parties hostage by saying, you know, look, you know, Bloomberg could say to the Democrats or the Republicans, you know, I will run and I will pull voters away from you, and split everything up so that the winning candidate is somebody who only gets, you know, 35% of the vote if you don't agree to make me vice president or adopt some policy position I want. So I worry about that kind of politics. I don't think we're not going to suddenly have a coalition system of government, whether we go with the popular vote, interstate compact, or something else. But I do think it would create some instability that I think is risky.
You believe it would encourage fringe parties and spoiler candidates and lead to winners with smaller and smaller pluralities. But you disagree with that, Ray?
Yeah, I mean, we got Ross Perot in 1992 and 1996, who was exactly the Michael Bloomberg, Tom Steyer kind of candidate. We survived that. Bill Clinton got 43% of the vote. Then we had Ralph Nader in 2000, who arguably cost Al Gore the presidency when Bush wins by 537 votes in Florida, and that was the margin of victory. The bottom line is, it is as bad under the current system as it would be under a national popular vote system. And in fact, a national popular vote system would lessen the impact that a Ross Perot or a Ralph Nader or a Jill Stein would have. You know, Jill Stein in Michigan in 2016 arguably cost Hillary Clinton Michigan. All of those various things occur. And when they pull, again, I'll use Ralph Nader as the best example. Ralph Nader got 75,000 votes in Florida in 2000 and arguably cost Al Gore the presidency. That is the kind of things that the winner-take-all laws in effect in 48 of the 50 states can cause. That would, if you got 75,000 votes out of 120 million, you would have absolutely no impact at all on a national level.
Let's go to Karen here. Hello, Karen.
Yes, hi, good evening. I've been listening to these debates, and it's clear to me that, one, the Electoral College needs to be abolished because it prevents every vote from counting. And anyone who's truly about moving the country forward, making sure that equality prevails, they're going to be in support of the Electoral College. This guest that you have here from Oklahoma, he said a couple of things that were so contradictory, one of which was that by maintaining the Electoral College, we can prevent things like what happened in Germany, which led to the rise of Hitler. But I would submit that the Electoral College has in fact created that very scenario here, and that we have a person who could not have won Congress or the Senate, but he found a way to scheme his way into the White House by two things. He drummed up the racist sentiments that exist in many Caucasian people, and I'm going to add this guy Trent to it. And secondly, he used outside influences so that he could use the propaganda so that he could put fear into people's hearts. That's exactly what Hitler did. And by the way,
okay,
Trump was born in Germany.
All right, I don't want her to attack you, Trent, there. She kind of did, but what she's saying, I'll let you speak to whatever, but what I think she's saying is Trump could not have won if he ran for Senate in the state of New York or in some, but he's managed to cobble together some states and win the presidency, and that wouldn't happen if it were a popular vote. I will say, I don't know, Karen, there are probably other people that believe a lot of what Karen just said. What do you say to that concern from Karen?
Yeah, no, I understand that concern, although I do think that we have a problem in our country where everyone wants to claim that the politicians they don't like, and you know, some of them are easy not to like, are the equivalent to Hitler or Mussolini or Mao or whatever, Stalin. And that does a real disservice to, for one thing, the 6 million plus people who were killed in the Holocaust, right? I think it's a real insult to those people to compare somebody who we don't like, you know, if you don't like his policies, you don't like his language, some of the things he's done, fine. I think, you know, a lot of people who voted for Donald Trump don't like those things either. But the idea that he's the equivalent to some, you know, murderous dictator, I think that's part of what's broken in our politics. That's the fear that Karen was talking about, is a fear that she seems to feel. Donald Trump won because he won over Obama voters. That's why he won the Electoral College. He won over Obama voters. He got people to flip from voting for Obama in 2012 to voting for Donald Trump in 2016. Hillary Clinton failed to motivate those voters, failed to build those coalitions. And, you know, and Ray mentioned this before, and I hate these sort of counterfactuals, but if we had had a popular vote election instead of the Electoral College, it's entirely possible that Donald Trump would have won. The popular vote margin was very close. But getting
because
to the
it would have changed,
point,
it would have changed the way he campaigned. And Ray, we're about to go to a break, but I want to let you come in on that too. I mean, what that caller just said is that Donald Trump wouldn't have won, or somebody like Donald Trump wouldn't have won. Do you agree with that or disagree? If we went to the popular vote, what you're talking about?
I honestly disagree with that because, again, Donald Trump did what it took to win. He had to win Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin to become president, and he won Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin. Now, he won those three states by less than 80,000 votes. 40,000 people in those three states changed their mind, and you're looking at President Hillary Clinton. But the bottom line is, he has said it, and I agree with him. He would have campaigned differently. He would have had to expand his campaign into other states. He would have had to come up with different policies that interested the people of Tennessee and Kansas and Missouri and Oklahoma to get them involved in the process instead of just catering to Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin, which is exactly what he did and what he had to do to win that election.
All right, we're going to take a break. We'll come back. We'll take more calls. Be back right after this.